for long. We're going to talk today about Prince Rupert Drops. Prince Rupert Drops. And yes, that's what you're going to see. We want to talk about Prince Rupert Drops. They are really very interesting. And here we go. So Prince Rupert Drops are toughened glass beads created by dropping molten glass into cold water, which causes it to solidify into a tadpole-shaped droplet with a long, thin tail. And you see a picture of what one looks like here again. It's sort of like a tadpole. It's a droplet of molten glass. It becomes cooled very quickly with this long tail on it. Okay. Now, these droplets are characterized internally by very high residual stresses, which give rise to counterintuitive properties such as the ability to withstand a blow from a hammer or even a bullet on the bulbous end without breaking. This is glass. Isn't that something to think about? These droplets also exhibit disintegration if the tail end is even slightly damaged. So if you bang like on a hammer on the big bulb end, or even shoot it with a bullet, it doesn't break. But if you just take it and barely tweak the tail of it, it just shatters instantly and into many, many pieces.
This lovely little drop called Prince Rupert's drop. Other names exist for it. Batavian tears, Dutch tears. These drops have been around for more than 400 years. And they first evoke interest because of some of their very curious properties. You can take this nice little drop and hammer it on the head with a common hammer. You will find that that drop is perfectly resistant against a fracture. On the other hand, if you snip the tail off, this whole thing will shatter into powder with a little pop noise. These drops were brought around 1661 by Prince Rupert from Europe and given to King Charles II as some sort of a memento. He gave a couple of the drops that Rupert had brought to his scientists and asked them to study these and explain to him their curious properties. High-speed photography was critical for explaining the explosive disintegration. In terms of why they withstand hammer blows, that required measurement of the stresses in the drops. And making measurements in objects of such complicated geometry requires a special type of photoelasticity called integrated photoelasticity that was pioneered by Professor Hilar Aben in Tallinn in Estonia. The very strong nature of the drops in the head is due to the large compressive stresses. And these stresses are much higher than have been measured in other types of glass blocks and glass plates and so on. All it requires is a glass rod of, say, leaded glass or soda lime glass, something with a high thermal expansion coefficient. So you heat the glass rod till it melts and forms a little bubble, and you let the bubble separate from the main rod and sort of cool in a beaker of water or a jar of water. The stresses that we measured are a consequence of the heating and the subsequent cooling of the drop in the water. That is what causes the stresses, and it is also what causes the particular distribution of stresses, which is compression on the surface and tension in the interior. Compression is good as a means of resistance against cracking. Tension is bad because things fly apart when you pull them, and pulling is tension. These glasses, which are fracture resistant, have found lots of applications. Now in cell phones and all the electronic devices that we carry around, they all owe their origin to this little fellow here, the Rupert drop.
There's some spiritual lessons I want to talk about concerning this idea. In Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, he says, "Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God." Think about that for just a minute. We are to lay aside how many sins and weights that so easily beset us, every one. And the reason we have to do that is because even the seemingly smallest sins can cause us to lose our way. In Acts of the Apostles on page 312, it says, "Envy, malice, evil thinking, evil speaking, covetousness, these are weights that the Christian must lay aside if he would run successfully the race for immortality." Every habit or practice that leads into sin and brings dishonor upon Christ must be put away, whatever the sacrifice. Whatever the sacrifice, it must be put away. The blessing of heaven cannot attain any man in violating the eternal principles of right. One sin, how many? One sin cherished is sufficient to work degradation of character and to mislead others. That Prince Rupert drop may be so strong at the bulb area, but just one little weakness will lead to its whole destruction. And then we have this statement from Education, page 150, paragraph 2. The strongest bulwark of vice in our world is not the iniquitous life of the abandoned sinner or the degraded outcast. It is that life which otherwise appears virtuous, honorable, and noble, but in which one sin is fostered. How many sins? One sin. One vice indulged. How many? One vice. To the soul that is struggling in secret against some giant temptation, trembling upon the very verge of the precipice, such an example is one of the most powerful enticements to sin. He who, endowed with high conceptions of life and truth and honor, does not yet willingly transgress one precept of God's holy law, has perverted his noble gifts into a lure of sin. Generous talent, sympathy, even generous and kindly deeds may thus become decoys of Satan to entice souls over the precipice of ruin. So just one thing, one simple thing can cause this kind of ruin. And then if you remember the story of David and Goliath, how many remember the story of David and Goliath? Everybody knows that story almost. But do you remember where David's stone hit Goliath? In his forehead. And do you know why it could hit him in the forehead and hurt him? Let's read. In Patriarchs and Prophets on page 648.1, it says, the anger of Goliath was roused to the very highest heat. In his rage, he pushed up the helmet that protected his forehead and rushed forward to wreak vengeance upon his opponent. The son of Jesse was preparing for his foe, and it came to pass when the Philistine arose and came and drew nigh to meet David, that David hastened and ran toward the army to meet the Philistine. And David put his hand in his bag and took thence a stone and slung it and smote the Philistine in the forehead, that the stone sunk into his forehead and he fell upon his face to the earth. Patriarchs and Prophets 648.1. And why was it that he was vulnerable there? In his cockiness, he kicked that helmet up and went toward David and exposed the very one place that he would be most vulnerable. One little spot brought down the giant. And so when we think of the Prince Rupert drop, remember that in our characters, in our lives, one little thing can bring the whole thing down. Wouldn't it be nice if we had a Prince Rupert drop here today to look at? Oh, wait a minute. We do. It's over here. So what we have on our table here is some water. We'll have that for safety reasons later. We have a couple hammers. Not to demonstrate for every action there's an equal and opposite reaction. We have two hammers. We have a little pair of cutters. Some tape. Maybe a paper towel if we need it. But here's what we really want. Inside this little packing material, what do we have here? We have a Prince Rupert drop. Can you see this? See how it has the big bulbous end and then the little tiny tail? That's one of them. I have another one in here. I think it's a little bigger. It's a little bigger drop. It has a little bigger tail. Can you see it? Okay. Yeah. Little tail. So it's very strong here, and out here it's what? Very weak. But if I break it here, it just doesn't break there. It destroys the whole thing. It disintegrates in just a fraction of a second. So what we're going to do, we're going to first demonstrate that the top part, this bulbous end, is indeed very strong. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to take a hammer here. I'm going to use it sort of as an anvil here. And I'm going to put a piece of tape on this to try to secure it, because if I let it slip, I could hit the tail, and I don't want to do that because I don't want to mess in here. I don't want to put glass everywhere in here. We're trying to do this right. Now, we did this. We tested this yesterday. It worked out real well. But now, today could be a different story. Need a little bigger piece of tape here. because I need to make this equivalent double-sided. And I'm going to try to elevate that a little bit. I don't know if you can see that there with your camera, Sherry, but I'm going to put my Prince Rupert drop on it right there like that. I'm going to take this one other piece of tape now. I'm going to try to secure the tail so it doesn't go anywhere. Can you see the drop now? And if you can't see it, you can move if you're in here in the sanctuary. Now we're going to take the hammer to it. This is just a 16-ounce Stanley ripping hammer. Didn't break.
Didn't break?
Now, I could hit it harder, but I don't want to dent the table underneath, right? But one day I'm going to set my .22 rifle and try to shoot one and see what happens. Got to be pretty accurate then. It's pretty hard. Pretty hard. So we see that the top is indeed hard, like they said. So let's see if we can gently take it apart here. Get the bottom of it off. Okay, there we go. Now what we're going to do, we're going to take it and we're going to have to focus in on this. This may be a little tricky to focus on with the camera, but we're going to try to focus on that. And we're going to put this drop in the water. And we're going to clip the tail and see what happens. It's going to happen really fast when it happens, so you got to watch really well. I hope I can get a hold of it just enough to hold it before it slips away from me. Ready? Did you see it? It's gone.
It exploded.
It's gone. It just exploded inside. There's just tiny little fragments of glass all through it. And that's why we put in the glass. We didn't want little, even though it was small, we didn't want it out here. But you see how it very quickly just exploded. You can, if you go to YouTube, you can see this in slow motion cameras, you know, those super slow motion cameras, and just it's pretty interesting. But friends, in our daily lives, this is what one sin does to us. One sin, one indulged vice, it will cause us all to be ruined, and we don't want that, do we? So help us by God's grace, Lord, to put sin out of our lives, to trust in Jesus Christ, and to know that He is able to keep us from falling.